Hello. My name is Ian, and as Celia said, I am an accessibility specialist. So that means that I work with people all around the industry to try and raise awareness and raise the bar for inclusion of people with disabilities in games. And the reason I'm talking about this at a UX summit is because it is part of UX. That's what my background was in before I moved fully over to accessibility. And everyone in the room, I'm sure, knows exactly what the U in UX stands for. It stands for users. It doesn't stand for subset of users who happen to not have an impairment at the moment. So it's something that's really, really important for all of us. If there's one person on the team who's got responsibility for standing up for the users, it's us, it's the people in the room. So accessibility is really, really important for all of us. And what I've got for you today is a run-through of some of the interesting things that have been happening over the past year in the field of accessibility. Because every year, the pace of change accelerates more and more. More and more people aware of what needs to be done, more and more people doing interesting things. And over that, I've been doing these kind of update talks for a couple of years, and for a few years. And increasingly, there's way too much stuff for me to be able to cover in the space of a talk, which is a really nice place to be in. So I'm just going to cover a few key themes that I've noticed over the past year. So this is advancements at platform level, corporate initiatives, increased dialogue with the audience, high-level support, legislation, which is actually something that's particularly relevant to UX and UR, and obviously accessibility in the games themselves. So starting with the platforms, I've got these two platforms in particular to talk. That's interesting. It looks okay on here. Well, you can still see the picture anyway. There's two platforms here that I'm going to talk about. One is the Xbox, and the other one is Nintendo Switch. And I'm going to talk about those two for very different reasons. So first of all, the Xbox. The Xbox, because they are a few years into their accessibility journey now. They've got all kinds of nice features on the platform itself, and the past year has been no different. They aren't resting on the laurels. They've implemented loads of cool new stuff. So things like upgrading Narrator, which is their text-to-speech functionality for blind gamers with new navigation mode. Upgrading their Zoom functionality. So within the console itself, you can zoom in. They've now upgraded that so you can lock the zoom-in position and play a game while zoomed in. They have opened up APIs so that at system level, a player can set whether or not they want high contrast. As a game developer, you can pull in that preference into your game and apply high contrast mode there. They've also included a text-to-speech API that allows two-way transcription between text and speech in online multiplayer communication. So if you've got text chat, it will translate that into speech. If you've got speech chat, it will translate that into text in both ways in real time. Another really, really nice feature they have in there is one called Copilot. Copilot is a feature that allows you to plug in two controllers and have each of those controllers do exactly the same thing as each other. And this opens up all kinds of nice possibilities. So you could have, for example, a kid playing a game, getting a bit stuck, and their parent able to jump in on the second controller and help them out a bit without the kid knowing. You can also have, for example, this was something I heard a blind gamer talking about recently, about them being able to play a first-person shooter game and understand the environment well enough to be able to do the aiming and shooting and have a friend sat next to them navigating the environment. But the core use case it was designed for is so you can split the controls between a single person. So you can, for example, control the left-hand side of one controller with your left hand, the right-hand side of a second controller with your foot. So if you've got, for example, one hand. So loads of really, really cool stuff that they've been doing at platform level. They've also, actually, one other thing that's worth mentioning is they now have a text-to-speech API for the interfaces in games as well. So that just basically sits there waiting for a text string. If any interface element in your game receives focus, you can just chuck out the text string, and that will then be spoken via synthesized speech according to the preferences set at system level, what language and what speed and stuff. So there's now a really, really easy way that you can make games blind accessible on the Xbox. And that's also in the PC as well through the Xbox SDK. So the other platform, Nintendo Switch, I'm going to talk about that for a slightly different reason. So the Switch has recently added in a couple of accessibility features too. These are some basic kind of initial ones aimed at vision impairment, so you can change the visuals to grayscale or inverted. And the reason why this is important isn't really so much because of the features themselves. It's because I normally can try and shy away from claiming that things are a first, but in this, I'm absolutely certain that this is a first. This is the first time in the history of the entire games industry that every major gaming platform, and by that at the moment I mean Xbox, Switch, PS4, iOS, Android, PC, every single one has accessibility options specifically for gamers with disabilities, which is a huge, huge landmark for the industry. So along those lines, also over the past year, there was the launch of platform accessibility guidelines. I mean, I'm not sure how many people in the room are actively developing consoles or operating systems, but there are now best practice guidelines with suggestions of all these kind of features that people can implement at that kind of level. Also on the topic of guidelines, Game Accessibility Guidelines had its fifth anniversary over the past year. That included quite a major content update with new best practices, new examples of games that are doing good things. Also some changes to functionality, including Excel export of the guidelines for use in QA and UX and all that kind of stuff. Sorry, go for it. Interesting. Sorry, I'm just enjoying that effect there. So there's been lots of kind of wide scale corporate initiatives going on as well. So this example is from Global Game Jam. I'm sure everyone in the room is familiar with game jams, but if not, it's, you know, games industry's equivalent of the hackathon. Global Game Jam is a huge one. Tens of thousands of people all over the world taking part. And the ESA, the Entertainment Software Association, which is the games industry body in the USA, actually sponsored an accessibility diversifier. So they're invested enough in accessibility now that they're actually paying money to encourage developers at Global Game Jam to think about accessibility. PlayStation had a Gamers with Disabilities reception at PSX, which is their main consumer event. Xbox as well, this is a charity called Warfighter Engaged in the USA. They were invited along to Microsoft Accessibility Bootcamp, which is basically an internal conference for all the various first-party Xbox development studios to learn about accessibility. This is a well-known advocate called Josh Straub with Shuhei Yoshida from PlayStation. So this is PlayStation doing a similar kind of thing, like an awareness-raising day with demos and guest speakers and stuff. This was part of Global Accessibility Awareness Day, which happens in the middle of May. And this past year, there was a ton of stuff going on in the games industry. So companies like PlayStation, BBC, Funko, holding these kind of big awareness-raising events, and all kinds of other individual developers and advocates doing articles, events, tweets, blog posts, all kind of stuff. So like I said, that's coming up in the middle of May. So if you ever need an excuse to be shouting about accessibility and letting people know about stuff you've done, why you think it's important, that's a really, really good excuse. Here's Josh Straub again. He's actually in this presentation three or four times, I think. He gets around a bit. But this is from another similar event, but this was a public-facing one. This is the Game Accessibility Conference, which we ran the first one of those last year. So a day-long conference dedicated solely to the topic of accessibility in games. Those kind of initiatives that I've been talking about are just kind of temporary, like one day kind of things. And there's also been some permanent things happen as well. So this is a picture of the Microsoft Inclusive Design Lab, or Inclusive Tech Lab, one of those two anyway. So basically, this is a permanent room that they've built on Microsoft campus, which the people here can see they're using some simulation goggles. That's part of it. The other part of it is they have loads of different nice bits of accessibility technology there for people to play with. So the idea behind the room is to have this space that people can come in and learn about accessibility, play with some of the technology, get an understanding of what kind of challenges are involved, what kind of problems need solving, and hopefully go away inspired. And this is open for public visits as well. So if you want to go and check it out, the chap on the left is called Bryce Johnson, Bryce J, B-R-Y-C-E-J on Twitter. If you want to go to Microsoft Campus and check it out anytime you're in Seattle, they take visitors. It's very, very cool. And this is a really important one. So Karen Stevens at EA Sports, the important bit here is accessibility lead. So in other industries, this kind of thing is really common. Like any decent-sized corporation, they have like a core accessibility team of permanent accessibility specialists. In the games industry, this hasn't really happened. Karen had a history of doing nice accessibility work within the Madden team. EA recognized that and have now given her a full-time permanent position working solely on accessibility. As far as I'm aware, there aren't yet any other positions like that in big studios and publishers. And that's something that I think now, well, I actually seen already, is starting to snowball. So I think we'll see a lot more of this in the coming years. And part of Karen's responsibilities there, as well as working and consulting on individual games, is managing relationships with the community. So having this presence on Twitter for open, free dialogue with gamers, also managing feedback that comes in, both through social media and through EA's forums, and circulating that amongst all the various different studios all over EA. And that kind of stuff has had a really big uptick in the past year, whether it's direct interaction like this, whether it's wide-scale stuff like Industrial Light and Magic and Ubisoft, both running some pretty big accessibility surveys with their audiences, whether it's individual producers being on Twitter, jumping on someone who's made some kind of accessibility feedback and wanting to know more and implement it in their games. And also greater inclusion of people with disabilities in user research. There's actually been some interesting developments, which I'm going to talk about a little bit later on, relating to that. But on that note, though, if that's something that you're considering yourself, if you're having any kind of difficulties with recruiting people with disabilities, the Able Gamers Foundation, which is a charity in the USA, now actually maintains a recruitment database specifically for people with disabilities who want to take part in user research and playtesting. So if you want to take them up on that, just Google Able Gamers Player Panels. So all these kind of corporate initiatives, they wouldn't be possible without high-level backing. And that's something that there's been a really, really big increase of. And you really need this kind of stuff. You know, if you're going to have any kind of lasting cultural change, the pressure needs to come from different angles. You need to have people on the ground who understand what needs to be done and want to do it. You need to have pressure from the outside, from your customers, from your players, saying this is something that we want to see happen. But you also really, really need to have it top-down. You need to have managers who actually understand and care and are willing to actually empower their staff to make these kind of changes. So you can see this quote here from Mike Ybarra, Corporate VP of Gaming for Microsoft. Phil Spencer, head of Xbox. Shohei again, president of Worldwide Studios for Sony. And you know, these kind of quotes from people at this kind of levels of the industry, this just would have been unheard of even just a couple of years ago. So it's a real sea change in attitudes towards accessibility in the industry. And I've got one more quote for you as well. So Kim Kardashian, what this is actually from, this is a fundraiser for Special Effect, who are an accessibility charity in the UK. And Kim Kardashian game makes a ton of money. So like donating that day's worth of revenue will have made a big difference to them. But why I'm showing you is for a different reason. It's because Kim Kardashian is one of the top 10 most followed people on Twitter. So the people working in advocacy in the room will understand the value of this really, really well. She has 60 million followers. So just getting those two words, disabled gamers, in front of an audience of 60 million people, that is just a staggering amount of awareness raising. And that kind of wide-scale awareness raising has been happening in the media as well. So this was an article that went out in The Economist about the business case for accessibility. BBC World News, this was actually a piece on blind accessibility. Another nice quote there from Phil Spencer. And I really, really can't understate the value of this kind of really broad awareness raising. Because it's exactly this kind of mass market kind of stuff that really, really drives awareness and acceptance, not just of accessibility, but of disability in general. So next up, legislation. So this is something that the games industry hasn't really had to deal with in a significant way before, apart from a few exceptions, like if you're working on games in a federal setting, like games used in government training or games used in education in the USA, then you're covered by a lot of accessibility regulation. This is a picture of Obama signing in a piece of legislation in 2010 called CVAA, which is the snappily named 21st Century Communications and Video Accessibility Act. This covers two things. It covers broadcast video, not relevant to games at all. It also covers communications technology across all industries. That does cover games. But because the primary purpose of games isn't communication, it's just kind of part of some games, the games industry was given a series of waivers to allow industry a bit of time to kind of figure out how to implement accessibility into their communications functionality. In December, just gone, the final waiver was granted. So there is now a concrete end date and compliance deadline. And that's 1st of January, 2019. So that means that if you have communications functionality in your game, it must be accessible to people with all kinds of disabilities. So not just the communications functionality itself, but also the route to it. So any interface that you need to use to access and operate that functionality. A lot of it is straightforward, making sure you know you've got decent contrast and configurable controls. Two things in particular that are worth noting is that the interface must be accessible to people who are blind. There are now tools that you can use, like the Xbox One that I mentioned. There's like a $70 Unity plugin that you can use. If you're developing like a native iOS app, you kind of get this kind of stuff for free. So that's one thing. The other thing is that you have to offer the same level of communication to everyone. So if you've got a game that relies on really fast, instant communication, that might then open you up to needing to include real-time transcription between text and speech that I was talking about earlier. So Xbox already offers that as an API. If you're not working on the Xbox, basically the turning text into speech is really, really dead easy. For turning speech into text, there are like third-party services that you can chuck your text out and have it sent back. Sorry, your speech out even. So CVAA, quite a few people know about CVAA. More people need to. You know, if you're working on a game that has communications functionality in it and your team isn't speaking about this kind of stuff, they really need to be. I mean, especially if you're working in a larger company, you've got lawyers on hand, you really need to be speaking to your lawyers about it. But one other, actually, I'm not going to get to this yet. I'm going to go back to this one again. One really, really interesting thing about this that kind of sets it apart from other accessibility legislation is that it mandates a user-centered design process. So actually it requires people with disabilities to be involved in the design process, and it also requires people with disabilities to be involved early in the design process. So that's really, really rare for legislation to actually mandate. It's up to you how you do it, but I'm sure you can see the implications for user research. So just really, really underscoring the importance of involving your community, involving user research, user testing, all that kind of stuff, and ensuring that people with disabilities are going to have a good experience with your game. And basically the reason why this is included is basically so companies can cover their back in case somebody makes a complaint about a game, that's all archived, that you know that we did actually take this into account. But obviously it also means that you're just going to end up with a good experience as well. So back to this one. So lots of people are, increasing numbers of people at least, are becoming aware of CVAA. There's actually another one as well. So this came about a couple of days after the CVAA deadline was set, the European Accessibility Act. So European Accessibility Act is similar. It requires accessibility in communications functionality. It also goes a little bit further and covers, it covers all kinds of things. The other thing that's relevant to games though is e-commerce. So that means if you're doing anything involving microtransactions, in-app purchases, that's also covered. It's not going to come for a long while, though. So how far this has got is, you can see this agreed its position So this is the start of a long chain of European government bureaucracy, essentially. So one of the three branches of government has decided roughly what the wording and stuff is it's going to be. It now enters a process over the coming year to get that turned into a law. Once it becomes a law, there'll then be another lengthy waiver period of like another 5 years or so. So this kind of stuff isn't coming till way down the line, but it's still really handy to be able to have visibility that this kind of stuff, is going to be coming. So all of that heavy legal stuff aside, I'm going to move on to the next thing. So basically this kind of stuff I've been talking about, like the legislation, the corporate initiatives, the high level support, the platform level stuff, that's all kind of the stuff that sits around games. And there's been a ton of nice stuff happening in games as well. Firstly, big games, going back in and patching accessibility functionality into existing titles. So like here, Overwatch starting to make moves to include captioning. Madden, this was a really, really cool one. So this was some of the stuff that Karen Stevens from EA was working on. And the short version of it is that the gameplay of Madden is now completely blind accessible. So a lot of it was kind of accessible anyway because the gameplay is narrated by the commentators. Karen went in and added in a whole bunch of haptic features. So basically, like when you got the kick meter on the screen, you get a level of vibration in your controller telling you how high the meter is. And that's made the whole of the gameplay completely accessible to people who are completely blind, which is obviously a nice kind of proof of concept. If you can make a game like Madden accessible to people who are blind, then everything else is pretty easy by comparison. Vaporum, this was really, really nice. This was, basically they patched in super hot mode. So you turn the option on, and just like in super hot, anytime you stop moving, everything else does as well, which is really, really great for motor accessibility, obviously for people who have bit slow reactions. Also really nice for cognitive accessibility as well. Things like autism, things like aphasia, where people need a bit more time to be able to process what's going on, understand it, and form a plan of what to do next. Mario Kart, I'm just gonna check my time. So when Mario Kart came to the Switch, they added in assists for steering and assists for acceleration. You can see this was allowing this kid with a stroke to play. I've also seen stuff with even gamers who are legally blind who just needed that little bit of extra assistance to be able to play at an enjoyable level. Code 7, this is another update for blind accessibility. So this was a text-based game, so this is more in line with the kind of accessibility that you see in kind of websites and stuff with screen readers reading text on the screen. What's been really nice though is seeing games that are thinking about accessibility earlier in the process, baking in accessibility from day one, and that allows you to do some really, really nice, well-integrated and cheap stuff. So this example from Nier, with its auto chips, which allow you to automate certain aspects of the gameplay, really useful for preferences, really useful for accessibility as well if there's some aspect of gameplay you find a bit too challenging. She Remembered Caterpillars. This is a game that is based entirely on color. You can see also it's based on mixing color as well. So you can see you've got, well, just about with the interesting effects, you can see it has purple, which is a mix of blue and red. That's the kind of mechanic that even just a couple of years ago would be completely written off as being impossible to make accessible to people who are colorblind. You know, it's inherently based on color. But you can see they've developed an additive symbol system that matches the additive color system. So red is squares, blue is circles, purple is a mix of square and circles. And you can see they've actually reflected that in the anatomy of the caterpillars as well. It's really, really nicely integrated into the design and feel of the game itself. And that's the kind of thing that you can't do through patching in later on. Games that have included a wide range of features as well. So Forza 7, you can see here, there's a bunch of features for low vision, color blindness, also a load of nice stuff for motor accessibility as well. You don't have to be a big company like Forza though. This list of features here, there's a ton of nice accessibility stuff. This is from their press kit. They actually did more things than this as well. So you can see there's a ton of nice stuff here. They're also considering color blindness and simulation sickness. This list of features is from a game called Midboss. And Midboss was developed by one single person. So again, that's a really nice example that if you consider accessibility early enough in development, there's a load of stuff that you can do really, really easily and have a huge impact on the experience of your players. Subtitles. This is something that I'm really excited to finally see some movement on, because subtitles in general in the industry are terrible. Loads of tiny texts, white text on the white background, way too many words on the screen. It's nice to finally see some progress on this. This example is from Hitman. Hitman allows you to change the size of your subtitles. Really small tweak, but one that makes a huge difference. And you can see here the number there, 46. That's really important. That's referring to 46 pixels. So if you're putting subtitles in the game, 46 pixels at 1080p, you need to at least have an option for that size. If you're only having one size, don't go beneath that 46 pixels. Assassin's Creed Origins. Assassin's Creed Origins had progress in their subtitles as well. They had a bunch of other nice stuff as well in there, like introducing difficulty levels, introducing tourist mode. This is the one that I'm most excited about, the subtitle progress. So you can see here, they don't have configurable size. They did use a decent size default. They went for that 46 pixels. You have the option to turn speaker name on and off. You also have the option to turn background on and off. So that black box behind the text to allow greater contrast. That's something that is standard in other industries. So like you open up YouTube, you open up Netflix, they give you those kind of options. I'm going to give you the entire list of games that I'm aware of that have ever implemented this feature in a game. Assassin's Creed Origins, Life is Strange. That's it. And how easy is that feature, you know? Turn on that black box on and off. So if you really want to be at the cutting edge of innovation in the games industry, do that. Let people turn that box on and off. And Assassin's Creed, actually, this is something that's quite rare for a big studio, is they actually shared the usage data on this. And averaged across their three platforms, the PlayStation, Xbox, and PC, the percentage of their players that use subtitles is 60%. So if you have a feature that is relied on by the majority of your players, it really, really justifies that extra bit of design work to make sure they have a good experience from it. So I'm going to wrap up now. I'm going to wrap up by stepping a bit outside the games to talk about Star Wars. So the reason I'm going to talk about Star Wars is because I had a look over the sales figures for Boxed Entertainment in the UK. And this is the sales figures for Rogue One. So not just Boxed, but also through digital platforms as well. So this is sales of DVDs, Blu-rays, Netflix, Amazon Prime, all that kind of stuff. Sold 1.38 million copies. Call of Duty, 2.44. FIFA, 2.69. So games are literally bigger than Star Wars. And the reason I'm bringing this up is because, you know, there's all kinds of reasons for considering accessibility. The ones you often hear about are the business case and also the human benefit, the difference it can make to people's lives. But this is another really important one as well, because, you know, Star Wars, that's obviously a huge cultural phenomenon. Games are as well. You know, when there's a big game coming out, you are bombarded by the media. It's what your friends are talking about, what your friends are doing. That means that it's, because it's such an ingrained part of our society and culture now, that makes it a really, really big deal to be excluded from it. But people don't have to be. I mean, you can see from the examples that I've been showing you that that kind of exclusion is happening less and less. We do still have a long way to go. People can be included much more than they currently are, but we are getting there. And the future, as a result, is looking very bright. Thank you.
Questions? Just one.
Hi, thank you for the talk. I'm Lisa from Space Ape Games in London, and I wonder if you have any examples of implemented accessibility guidelines in mobile games.
Yes, I do. That's too long of an answer for this talk. But if you look up GCAP, so GCAP, that's Game Connect Audio Pacific, GCAP accessibility and mobile devices, that will get you an hour-long talk which talks specifically about mobile accessibility. Any other takers? Nope, great. Okay, well, if anyone wants to talk to me, oh, it's gone. Okay. was going to say, here's my contact details. But anyway, it's just at @IanHamilton_. I'm always happy to talk. And the link that was up there on the screen as well, the one to the quotes, those three quotes that I gave you, there was a ton of other ones on there, loads of really nice educational inspiration stuff. So thank you.
Thank you, Ian.